everyone please be seated? Welcome to the 1995 Reflection Ceremony. Tonight, we will be looking back on our wonderful memories that consist of friends, faculty, and family. Now, I will be turning the program over to Tiffany Rosenberger, who will be reading her original poem, Riding the Winds of Time, which is our theme for this year's reflections.
From the cocoon, the butterfly takes the knowledge of advancement. With strong wings, the butterfly attempts another day. But with each day, he builds strength of physical as well as mental stature. The accomplishments are satisfaction enough to try even more difficult tasks. When it is finally time to fly away to unknown places, then the butterfly is truly tested. So many questions of where and how need to be answered. The butterfly waits to take flight for this infinite adventure. Each line and spot on the back of the butterfly create the intricate pattern of many years of development. The lines closest to the edge are the hardships. The large round spots are the friends and acquaintances. And every other line is the never-ending support of those who love us. It is time now for the butterfly to take flight.
Remembering a time I could not stand, relieved to know there was always a helping hand. Days going by keep greeting the past. I don't know how long I thought this would last. Wasn't too long ago I thought I'd never see the day, but for now I must wash away all my failures and every fear, because despite the odds, I got here. Nothing is over, this is not the end. I still have time, and I still have my friends. And although I can now stand on my own, I'm not too proud to say I don't want to stand alone.
You've had since kindergarten.
One on whom you can depend.
Who else would come out in the pouring rain just to rescue you because your car broke down?
Hey, that's what friends are for.
A friend can help to mend a heart.
After being dumped, just when you thought it was the end of the world, who else but your friends sat up all night and gave you shoulders to cry on?
Your friends boost you toward a brand new start.
Friends clown with carefree schoolgirl glee.
Who cares if you don't have a date? Your friends would say, at least we have each other.
A friend would always share a quiet cup of tea.
Or coffee at where else but Denny's. Okay, so it wasn't very quiet, but you sure had a lot of fun.
Friends nurture you when you feel low.
Don't worry, things will get better. Every dark cloud has its silver lining.
Friends gossip when they're in the know.
Your friends always knew who was with whom and stopped all rumors of you.
Friends celebrate the good times too.
Who else danced the night away with you at the prom and was still up and ready for celebrating afterwards? Or what about rolling and sliding in the mud with friends at the annual powder puff games?
Many things have happened through our school years.
Times of laughter and times of tears.
But one thing I can always do
is to be sure to count on
friends like you.
It's hard for anyone to accept losing someone very close. But in April of this year, the members of the class of 1995 lost a very special member, Josh Nielsen. I'm here to pay tribute to Josh and all the qualities that made him special to us. Josh had great character, a wonderful sense of humor, and the uncanny ability to turn a bad situation into a good one. Josh was very much his own person. Whether kidding around with his friends or drawing a caricature, Josh was truly an artist. Josh wasn't the kind of person to say, "Hey, I heard a great joke." But his unique perceptions of people and situations made Josh the one we all like to be around. His artwork was especially unique. Josh liked to entertain himself and the others by imagining and then drawing his friends as somewhat bizarre characters. He drew one friend as he might look in 20 years, and another as an Avon lady. We knew Josh wasn't making fun of us, and we looked forward to seeing what he would come up with next. But there was more to Josh than a funny comment or a clever drawing. He was a great listener, especially one-on-one. If you had a problem, you could tell Josh what was wrong, and somehow he found a way to help you see the humor in the situation. It's difficult to accept this loss. We have so many questions and so few answers. We all miss Josh and love him. But I do know that Josh made a difference in our lives, and he'll always be a member of the class of 1995. I would like to dedicate a line from one of Boyz II Men songs to Josh. Because even though when times got rough, you never turned away. You were right there, and I thank you.
In the fall of seventh grade, I remember wanting, more than anything else in the world, a navy blue corduroy North Penn jacket. All of my friends had one, and I thought that was the coolest thing ever. So just before winter, my parents bought me one. The first thing I looked at was a name and year that appeared in the front. It read, Mike, 95. To be honest, when I looked at it then, all that it was to me was a couple of numerals on a jacket. Until one night this past January, I turned on the television to watch a college bowl game. The announcer said it was the first college football game of 1995. I did a double take. For the first time in my life, that number, 95, actually had a great deal of meaning. It meant that soon I'm going to graduate and move on to start a whole new stage in life. To tell you the truth, I have many mixed emotions about leaving. North Penn High School is a place I know well. It is where all my friends are, and a place where I spent the majority of my time the past 3 years. Whether it was in the classroom, the accolade office, or on the football field, I was here for what sometimes felt like forever. If there was ever a bad moment, though, I knew that I had friends here to pick me up and straighten me out. For what really is a senior but a kindergartner with 12 years of experience? I think one of the harsh realities of life is going away and having to deal with problems in your own ways, without your friends. I now look back on my high school career, and I know that it has prepared me to take on the challenges that lie ahead. The biggest reason for that is the friends that surrounded me while I was here. Even now, when I walk into the football field or go into certain restaurants, I think of the times I spent there with my friends and how much I will miss not being there with them next year. From each step in life, we take different values and ideals to shape our future. From this one, I will take away the memories of my first true friends and a sense of togetherness I have never felt before. All these memories can be summed up in two words: high school. It will be a time in my life I will remember forever. To this day, I still keep that old beat-up jacket. It doesn't fit anymore, but believe me, the name and number on it have more meaning now than I could have ever imagined.
Relationships in which we can have different facets to our lives, yet to use those differences to bring us closer together. We've encountered many people in our years at the high school. Friendships are made, but rarely stay strong throughout the years. The true friends are always the hardest to find, and it is the trust, love, and honesty which is hardest to maintain to achieve that strong friendship. It was these few treasured friends who listened to you when you broke up with that oh-so-special boyfriend whose name you can't seem to recall now. It was they who knew almost better than you yourself did. When singing along with the Dirty Dancing soundtrack, it never mattered how off-key we were. It was harmony to us. And it was amazing how one name seemed to become synonymous with four. But the good times are easy to handle. It is the trying times which really test the relationships. Only the true friendships can endure the jealousy, envy, and pettiness which always accompany the teenage years. For example, how many people do you know that can survive a week at the shore with four girls sharing one bedroom and one bathroom? Moving on without each other will probably be the hardest thing we've had to deal with so far in our lives. We will miss the excitement of finding out that we had lunch together for the first time new school year, and the experience of driving with our parents in the school parking lot for the first time. And how could we forget the sight of us, still little girls at heart, all dressed up for our first formal, the ninth grade dance. Because we will not be able to recapture these times, we must tuck those memories in that familiar place in our hearts. So when we need something to reassure us, we can look back on those times and know that we have something familiar to look for strength. Just as we huddled together during the scary scenes of Jurassic Park, we now look to one another for the strength to go on off on our own. Before the dust begins to thicken on our memories of high school,
We take this time tonight to recognize those who allowed us to be ourselves, but were always there with an understood support and appreciation for the differences between us. As the years progressed, it was naive to think that we would not change as well. We have learned, often the hard way, to move with the changes, not against them. We have learned to hold our memories close to us, because if we're not careful, time will steal those away as well. So as we venture to leave what we know is warm and familiar, it is safe to say that we will be packing much more than clothes for the trip. When we first walked down these wide, long hallways here at North Penn High School, we were scared. We were frightened. But for the past 3 years, the faculty have helped us, giving directions and getting us through the worst of times. And it made me think of the Maya Angelou poem, "Life Doesn't Frighten Me at All." Shadows on the wall, noises down the hall, life doesn't frighten me at all. Bad dogs barking loud, big ghosts in a cloud. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Mean old Mother Goose, lions on the loose. They don't frighten me at all. Dragons breathing flame on my counterpane. That doesn't frighten me at all. I go boo, make them shoo. I make fun, way they run. I won't cry, so they fly. I just smile. They go wild. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Tough guys in a fight, all alone at night. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Panthers in the park, strangers in the dark. No, they don't frighten me at all. That new classroom where boys all pull my hair, kissy little girls with their hairs and curls, they don't frighten me at all. Don't show me frogs and snakes and listen for my scream. If I'm afraid at all, it's only in my dreams. I've got a magic charm that I keep up my sleeve. I can walk the ocean floor and never have to breathe. Life doesn't frighten me at all. Not at all, not at all. Life doesn't frighten me at all. This poem reminds me of our life here at North Penn, how it began, and finally, tomorrow night, how it ends. We were frightened on those long hallways, but thanks to the goodness and kindness of all our teachers, we have made it to today, ready to go on to a life that doesn't frighten us at all, ready to use our skills that they taught us in the world where we were all a family. But as we move, they will move with us, in our hearts and in our minds. They will never leave us, always reminding us to do our best and to try a little harder. They will never know how much they meant to us unless we tell them. And finally, we must thank them for their help and guidance, for without our teachers, we would not be here today.
Teachers, and they all had one thing in common. They all gave of themselves to help us. I once saw a bumper sticker that said, "If you can read this, thank a teacher." And it made me think, teachers are some of the most important people in a person's life. We dedicate the Giving Tree to those special teachers who have always been there to help us, even when we didn't give them the respect they deserved. Tomorrow, we will leave the stage in our lives called high school. But before we go, we want to say thank you to all the teachers who have touched our lives through the years.
Once there was a tree who loved a little boy.
Every day I would come and gather all of her leaves and make them into crowns so that I could play king of the forest.
He would come and climb up my trunk. He would swing from my branches and even eat my apples. And occasionally, we would play hide-and-go-seek. When he grew tired, he would come and sleep in my shade.
I love the tree, and I am very happy.
I, too, am very happy.
As time went by, the boy grew older, and the tree was often lonely. Then one day, the boy came back to the tree, and the tree said,
"Come, boy, come and climb up my trunk, and swing from my branches, and eat my apples, and play in my shade, and be happy."
I am too big to climb and play. I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money?
I'm sorry, but I have no money. I have only leaves and apples. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city. Then you will have money, and then you will be happy.
And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away. And the tree was happy, but the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree grew sad. And then one day, out of the blue, the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy, as she said,
"Come, boy, come and climb up my trunk, and swing from my branches, and be happy."
I am too busy to climb trees. I want a house to keep me warm. I want a wife, and I want children. So I need a house. Can you give me a house?
I have no house. The forest is my home. But you may cut off my branches and build a house, and then you'll be happy.
And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away to build a house. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long, long time. And when he came back, the tree was so happy she could hardly speak.
Come, boy, come and play.
I am too old and sad to play. I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat?
Cut down my trunk and make a boat so that you can sail away and be happy.
Once again, the boy did what the tree suggested. He cut down her trunk, made a boat, and sailed away. And the tree was happy, but not really. After a long time, finally the boy came back.
I am sorry, boy, but I have nothing left to give you. My apples are all gone.
My teeth are too weak for apples.
My branches are all gone. You can't swing on them.
I'm too old to swing on branches.
My trunk is gone. You can't climb.
I'm too tired to climb.
I'm sorry. I wish I could give you something. I have nothing left. I am just an old stump. I'm sorry.
I don't need very much now. Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I'm very tired.
Well, an old stump is a good place for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit and rest.
And the boy did, and the tree was happy.
The end.
When I was a sophomore, I had him for public speaking and debate. My brother encouraged me to take his class because it was an interesting and fun course, and Mr. Lassen was a great teacher. He brought an excitement to our class. He was always ready to teach, with his planner out and the board set with a schedule for the week. He was even excited to teach. He was one of those teachers that you wanted to impress and wanted to do well for. He had a rare love of teaching. He had a gift and shared it with everyone.
Mr. Lassen always said he was here to advise us, not to tell us what to do.
He treated us as mature adults and let us handle our class functions in our own style. As one of the class historians, I valued Mr. Lassen's advice. Starting with the first day of school, he always made sure that a roll of film was waiting for me in my mailbox. Routinely, he would ask, "Are you taking those pictures? Make sure you're getting different people in them." Always a step ahead and taking into account every situation. Mr. Lassen was not only an advisor, but also a great motivator. His concern was that all the members of the class of 95 have a face and a voice in our class history. Tonight, we acknowledge his place in ours.
He called me Jeff. My name was Jeremy. I called him Chuck. His name was Mr. Lassen. He called me Bob. I was an intrigued student. I called him Joe. He was a knowledgeable teacher. Every homeroom began and ended in this manner. It all started when I walked into the class government homeroom for the first time, and Mr. Lassen called me Jeff. So I called him Chuck. It seemed like an innocent joke, but it escalated to a daily activity that occurred each and every time we encountered each other. It was this kind of humor that made Mr. Lassen a joy to be around.
Mr. Lassen's advice was never to dwell on the past, but apply past teachings to the future. He taught everyone to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield in the pursuit of reaching personal goals. He treated us all equally with respect, only with the hope of bringing our true abilities to the surface. Mr. Lassen will always be remembered in the words of Tennyson's Ulysses, "I am a part of all that I have met."
Racing past a convenience store on my new mountain bike, I thought back to the day more than a decade ago when I first biked to the 7-Eleven near my home. Being granted permission to make this trip, I raced out of the door with plans of buying the largest Slurpee available. After handing the cashier a week's worth of allowance with the pride of being a working man, I sauntered out of the store. I returned to an anxious mind, thinking I had traveled to the limits of the world, when I had actually gone no further than the end of my street.
Now, 12 years later, our situations are much changed. Somewhere between our elementary school days and our senior year, we have come to understand that the world is something enigmatic and vast. We have learned that a bicycle cannot take us to the edge of the world, and we have learned that the earth will not stop for the antics of two young sisters dancing to Swan Lake.
Through the middle school and junior high years, this understanding often seemed overwhelming, and at times it still does. But our perception of the world has changed. Our teachers have helped us turn the world's limitless boundaries into an empowering reality, not a frightening one.
History was once no more than an imposing expanse of time, but social studies teachers converted that expanse into a meaningful series of interlocking events, each with its own cause, each with its own effect. English class took those events and related them to literary movements, bringing another human dimension to history's records. Science classes revealed how complex the natural world is, but also made it into something understandable. The smallest particles and the most immense bodies are governed by laws and operate in regular patterns. Add to these entry points the self-confidence, critical thinking skills, strength, and spirit, which develop in step with the acquisition of knowledge, and the world becomes something that is not only immense, but also dynamic.
The North Penn faculty gave us what we needed to cope with the complexities of this world, a foundation to build our castles on. As we prepare to pack our bags, our minds intent on the journeys we have planned for ourselves, we leave behind a group of people who have grounded us in reality, empowering us to pedal far beyond our hometown roots and earn the right to curtsy as we dance on the spinning world.
Mom and You put me on earth and loved and cared for me ever since birth. You gave me tons of hugs and helped me get over those awful flu bugs. Your patience was always there, even the time I chopped off a piece of my hair. My memories are all so fond, especially the one of us waddling across the frozen pond. You have always liked my friends, and tonight we're here together in the end. You gave me a wonderful sister, and when she left me for college, boy, did I miss her. You showed me the way, even when the path was gray. With all the love you gave me, I don't doubt it's hard to set me free. Mom and Dad, this wonderful experience sends me a whirl, but I promise you this, I'll always be your little girl. Leaving you makes me a bit sad, but I'm ever so glad that God made you my mom and dad.
In our lives, we've taken many first steps. Our first step is we went from being a crawling baby to being a walking toddler. Our first step into the driver's seat of a car. And tomorrow, our first step out of North Penn High School as graduates. As we took all of these steps, our family was of the greatest importance to catch us as we inevitably fell, to hand us the keys, and to remain as one of the only constant and unchanging qualities in our turbulent and uncertain world. We stand ready to face a society in which we will have to find our own path on which to lead our lives. And in this maelstrom of uncertainty, our families will be the only constant, unbending source of love, the only place where we can be unafraid to seek guidance as we approach the unfamiliar. Our families are the single source from which we can derive absolute trust, and from which we have complete support as we begin the long, strange trip which starts tomorrow as graduates of North Penn. So, as we prepare for the journey of our lives, we must look forward, for that is the only means by which we can progress to being just, noble Americans. But we must also look back and reflect on how truly important our families have been, and then we must thank them, for they have done truly wonderful things to bring us to this point in our lives.
we've been close to inseparable. Dancing in school talent shows, lip-syncing to our favorite Go-Go's tune, practicing our back walkovers for gymnastics, or even just sharing the same room together, we have always been able to depend on each other. Even through our disagreements over boyfriends to our fights over borrowing each other's clothes, we have managed to stay close sisters and most of all, best friends. I always look forward to our nighttime talks about school, guys, or anything that seemed important at that moment. It is so nice to know when something is wrong or if it needs someone to confide in, I will always have my sister. Now, 18 minutes apart have turned into 18 years later. And for the first time, we will face obstacles and take risks alone in an unfamiliar place. Tomorrow night, when we end the final chapter in the book of our high school years, I know that I will be starting a new beginning in the fall and a new place without my sister. For the first time in my life, I will not be called the wrong name or be forced to argue with my sister about something that she borrowed. Instead, I will be by myself with new experiences and new people to meet. No matter how far away we are from each other, the bond between us is unbreakable. No one can take away my sister. Our relationship will never change. Whatever path I choose in life, my sister will always be a part of it. Always and forever, my best friend.
Trying to get her there.
Hearing your child's name announced as she receives her diploma.
hoping she'll return safely from senior week.
Helping her move into her new room at college.
Driving away, feeling like you've left something behind.
For all the sacrifices that you have made for our well-being, and for all the support that you have given us with all of our endeavors, we are grateful.
You have made an impact on us that will last a lifetime. Your constant understanding and encouragement will always be remembered. We hope that someday we can become as well revered by our children as you are by us.
We love you, Mom and Dad.
As I reflect back on my many years that I have spent in the building as both a teacher and now as an administrator, the one thing I always remember wishing for was a window with a view. My old classroom in E26 only had a view of the back wall of the pool and the H-pod. Not bad, but I often thought it could be better. Gazing at bricks certainly wasn't the pastoral setting that I was searching for when I looked across that courtyard. No babbling brook or wildflowers from this location, I often thought. But maybe, just maybe, someday things will change and I'll have a window with a beautiful view. Then, like Poe's raven, an opportunity came tapping on my window. A chance to become an administrator at North Penn Junior High School. Surely a challenge, I thought, but finally one with a view. Well, Penn Street was lovely, and my window now could be open from the inside of my office, but it still wasn't what I had envisioned. And as the seasons and years passed, I still longed for my window with a view. Someday, I thought, things will change, and I'll be able to look out the scene of my dreams. 2 years ago, another opportunity developed when Dr. Vaughn offered me a chance to come to the high school as an assistant principal to lead a group of students, then soon to be juniors, known as the class of 95, through to seniorhood. I pondered, almost wistfully, my chance for a window that finally has a view. I arrived in the summer of 1993 anxious to see what my new window would reveal. When I looked out at first, I saw only the same courtyard and bricks I had seen for so many years before, only now from the second floor. However, a transformation began to take place the more I looked out my vantage point. To my amazement, I saw things in that courtyard I had never seen before. I could now see past and present, successes as well as failures. I watched friends laughing and crying, working, and just having fun. The view from my window let me share and touch, listen, and learn. I watched students dancing at proms, garnering awards at banquets, and competing at athletic events. Each day I saw clearer through my window than I did the day before. And if I really looked especially hard, I watched the actual dreams and hopes and plans of our young people unfold right before my eyes. Funny, I thought, I never could see any of this from my old windows. Gradually I began to understand what had happened. The view that I gazed upon had always been there, regardless of the window that I had used. The problem, of course, was that I didn't know what I was supposed to see. Experience now tells me that all of you will have a window with a view someday, just like the one that I now have. I hope that you find that what you see is as focused and as insightful as the images that come into view through my window now on the second floor. Family, friends, colleagues, all blending together into one intricate scene of life and fulfillment. Oh, by the way, the view that I could never see, but now enjoy, is you, each and every one of you. Best wishes, class of 95. It has been, and will always be, rewarding for me to watch you grow through my window on the second floor.
In September, no one could have imagined the way our senior year would unfold. When most of us came to this part of our high school lives, we said, hey, it's all downhill from here. And we were almost right. Yet we never imagined the uphill climbs we would need to make in order to reap the benefits of the downhill sweeps. Many things made this year hard to endure for everyone. Whether it was losing a close friend, a teacher, or a family member, or trying to regain focus after a long 19-day teacher strike. Whether it was dealing with the financial burdens of losing a job, or trying to figure out how to pay for future educational investments, this year has been a struggle beyond what most people would have expected. With the struggle came emotional anguish. Feelings of anger and distress followed each problem around every corner, ensuring pain while traveling along our personal journeys through life's gauntlet. It reminds me of the scene from Forrest Gump, when Jenny and Forrest revisit Jenny's childhood home. The moment Jenny sees the home that represents her youth, she picks up rocks from her old driveway and throws them at the house, as if to destroy the symbol that represents her horrible childhood. But her past could not be undone. We too have learned that the sad realities rough times can bring cannot be converted into pleasant, painless experiences. We may at times find ourselves pleading for the problems to just stop and just go away. As Forrest said, sometimes there just aren't enough rocks to throw. The challenge then is to move beyond these experiences to what the new horizon holds. As one senior said, this year some people were just forced to grow up. When we find ways to overcome the inability to accept the problems, we allow ourselves the ability to transcend the barriers to success. As Belgian philosopher Maurice Maeterlinck said, happiness is rarely absent. It is we that know not of its presence. Seniors, when you look back on this year, be thankful. It has not been an easy year to experience, but it has been a profitable one. Life isn't always about being happy. It's about learning to deal with what you have been given and make the most of it. So look ahead to what the future will offer and never forget the past and its teachings. Those who can rise above the storm will lead tomorrow.
Ceremony, I had no idea how I would go about reflecting on the past 13 years of our school lives. There are no words to glorify the first day of kindergarten when your mom dressed you up in the prettiest dress with the coolest outfit and led you all the way down to your bus stop. Perhaps
even waited until you got on the new big yellow bus. And as you waved to her from your school bus window, you couldn't imagine that within 13 years, you would be doing the same thing again. Only this time, instead of waving away your preschool years, you would be saying goodbye to your childhood friends, junior high dances, and high school parties, but never to the people who have made an indelible mark on your lives. For some, our mothers have been the ones that have lifted our heads up when we've been down. Others have dads, sisters, brothers, or even best friends or teachers that know just how to make us laugh when the time is right. Such special people come by only once in a lifetime. The next time you see them, capture their smile, their laughter, and even their mannerisms that seem so bothersome to you at times, and tuck those memories in a special place in your heart that can easily be found. Later, when you feel lonely and unsure of yourself, you can just pull out one of those fond remembrances, and you will then be able to feel them almost beside you. Tonight, as we bid farewell to our past, we are also welcoming our future with open arms. Parents, teachers, and students alike will be able to congratulate themselves on how much they have achieved and anticipate what there still is to be accomplished. Winning Powder Puff for the second year in a row, voicing our opinions during the strike, dancing to Friends in that unforgettable circle at our senior class dinner, and having the time of our lives at the senior prom are some of our most vivid memories. We, the class of 1995, have been able to do such fine work because of the people who have influenced our lives the most. This evening, I'm here to thank all the wonderful people, the friends, faculty, and family, who have given of themselves to encourage and support the fine soon-to-be graduates that are sitting before me. In the words of Albert Schweitzer, there are in everyone all sorts of good ideas, ready like tinder. But much of this tinder catches fires, or catches it successfully. Only when it meets some flame or spark from the outside, it lights. We, the graduates of 1995, thank you for being that spark to light us. Thanks.
As he rose to speak to his seniors for what may be the last time, he said, "I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my students, you will be." And as for his parting gift, he wished for them to remember the A, B, and C's of schooling. A is for the advice we gave from the heart, and B is for being the best that you can be. C is for the creativity so many of you have to give, and D is for the devotion you have for one another. E is for the excellence you bring to all you do, and F is for the fairness in your treatment of others. G is for the goodness in each one of you, and H is for the help that we hope we gave. I is for the individuality you have developed, and J is for the joy you bring to all of our lives. K is for the knowledge that you have acquired, and L is for the love we always have for each other. M is for the money that we hope that you will make. And N is for not quitting, even when you've had more than you can take. O is for the opportunities that will come your way. And P is for the pat on the back you received when you needed an okay. Q is for the quiet time that you will need to find. And R is for the rest that is always on your mind. S is for the sensitivity you show to one another. And T is for the thoughtfulness you give to others. U is for the unselfishness that you showed you really care. and V is for the victories you had and will continue to score. W is for the win-win attitude you need to hold so dear. And X is for the xylophone that introduced the announcements. X is for the xylophone that introduced the announcements that you were supposed to hear. Y is for the yearbook in which your history and memories are stored. And Z is for the zest we hope you bring to the rest, the very, very rest of your life. Then he left the stage, moved to his office, where a picture of the class was hung. He took it down, he sat, and he pondered all of the memories, particularly the truck in the parking lot. Walk out, no come in. But as he pondered that and all the academic successes, as he viewed all of the faces, he said, you know, I will love you forever. I'll like you for always. Not only my students, but my friends, you will always, always be. May God bless each one.
Called the black swallowtail. When the butterfly emerges from the cocoon, the
but cannot yet take flight because its wings are not fully developed. Throughout high school, until this night, we have all been emerging from our cocoons. We have each developed our own distinct personality. We've grown academically and have acquired the knowledge and skills we need to feel confident in whatever we pursue. Most noticeably, however, we've grown socially and have become responsible young adults. We've made friends to last a lifetime, friends that we love and can never forget. And although we've grown to become strong individuals with almost developed wings, we haven't yet felt comfortable and confident enough to spread our wings until now.
In the butterfly's final stage, its wings are fully developed. It is now ready to take flight and let the world see its beauty. Tonight has been a time of reflection, a time to look back on what it has taken to develop the wings which we are now about to use. Tomorrow night, we will all stand in colorful gowns, diplomas awaiting us. With only one more day of high school, we believe we are ready to spread our wings and boast our colors to the world. Class of 1995, we are ready to take flight, and tomorrow night, we will finally get to do so. At this time, we would like each senior to stand. Come forward and take a butterfly as you recess from tonight's reflection ceremony.